The Governor, aka Philip Blake, is the first major human antagonist in both The Walking Dead comics and TV show. He's portrayed as a charismatic leader of Woodbury, a fortified town which retains civilization in the midst of the zombie apocalypse. Of course, there's a dark side to Blake. Behind a charming surface lies an evil monster, a power-mad and paranoid lunatic who'll stop at nothing to get what he wants, whether it be more weapons and supplies, safety for his loved ones, or revenge. The Governor is a very complex character and one of my personal favorite villains in fiction. When I say that, I'm really referring to the TV show version, not the comics. The comic book Governor is a pretty basic madman, a sick and despicable bastard who kills anyone for no real reason and loves to torture and rape people. He's also a coward and hides behind others when the going gets tough. I'm not saying he's a bad antagonist. He works great as a foil for Rick Grimes and his group of zombie apocalypse survivors in the comics, an evil force who messes shit up. And boy does he mess shit up. The Governor causes a lot of harm to Rick and his people, maybe even more than later villains. I mean, remember that final attack on the prison? Did anything so dramatic and devastating ever happen during Negan or the Whisperer's reigns? But while comics Blake was a fantastic foe, he was a crappy character. Over the top evil and insane on the level of a Looney Tune. The TV version, while very evil too, is entirely different. That's what I'm here to talk about today. Why I feel that TV Governor is so much better than comic Governor. I know it's been talked about before, but considering I like the character so much, I want to throw in my two cents as well. And to be fair, most videos on the Governor are pretty old by now, as the character is old news, seeing as he's been dead for quite a while. On the TV show, the Governor, played by David Morrissey, is given a lot more depth. Both versions have a chained-up zombified daughter named Penny in their studies. Comics Governor seems to do this simply because he's nuts, and he does pretty weird stuff with his zombie daughter too, like that time he kissed her right on the lips. That's disgusting and pretty dangerous too. And who kisses their daughter on the lips anyway, even if she wasn't a freaking rotting corpse? On the show, Governor never does something so insane and gross. He instead attempts to groom her, like brushing her hair. He also sings to her and seems to want to treat her as if she was normal, but gets very frustrated when that doesn't work. He's living a lie, trying to convince himself that there's something left of Penny inside that thing, when in reality he knows better. Immediately, this is far more compelling and makes TV Blake a more interesting character. But that's not all. Like I said, comics Blake keeps Penny around for no real reason. Well, TV Blake actually has a reason, besides sentiment. On the show, Blake has a friend named Milton Mamet, who conducts research on zombies, trying to find answers about the disease and hopefully also a cure. Governor supplies Milton with whatever resources he needs for his experiments. And this is the real reason Penny hasn't been put down yet. Blake is hoping, in vain of course, that Milton will come up with a cure. He seriously believes that there might actually be a way to bring his daughter back. In the comics, the Governor is a complete madman from the moment we first meet him. In the very first issue featuring the character, he makes it clear that in Woodbury they feed strangers to zombies. In the next issue, he chops off main character Rick Grimes' hand, for no real reason. Needless to say, he was always Satan, and there's no journey into darkness. We get no setup for his madness. Again, a good antagonist, but a bad character. In his introduction on the show, Governor was certainly no saint, but he was far less evil and crazy than he'd later become. On the show, it's heavily implied that Blake used to be a completely normal man before the zombie outbreak. He had a wife and a daughter and a normal job. His wife died in a car crash sometime before the outbreak, and I suspect this was the first step of his descent into madness. We don't get any information about Blake's wife in the comics. Now, I know there's a novel which explains his origins, but I'm not taking that into consideration here, as it's a completely different medium. This is the comics and TV show we're talking about here, and nothing about his background is even hinted at in the comics. Anyway, following the zombie apocalypse, Blake is left to protect his daughter alone, although Milton might have been present here as it's explained they used to know each other. Nevertheless, at some point, Blake fails at keeping Penny safe. We never find out how, and she's bitten, being turned into a walker. This man, already mourning his dead wife and dealing with the end of the world, has now lost his daughter. Clearly, this is another step towards madness, and the moment which created the Governor we first meet on the show. A brutal killer who does anything to keep his people, his town, and most importantly, zombie Penny safe. He's still reasonable though, and keeps the ordinary Woodbury citizens out of his messier affairs. For those matters, he employs a special group of soldiers, hardened men already used to violence even before the apocalypse. apocalypse, like Merle Dixon and Cesar Martinez. This changes later though, after a crucial turning point, namely the death of his daughter. Sure, she was technically already dead, but remember, Blake didn't want to believe that. But after Michonne runs a samurai sword through Penny's skull, there's naturally no coming back anymore, not even if they did find a cure. It seems that zombie Penny was the only thing that still kept Blake within at least some boundaries of decency. Now that she's gone, that's gone too. Following this event, and of course also the stabbing of his eye by Michonne, the governor goes completely off the deep end. Now he begins to attack Rick's group at the prison relentlessly. He already expressed a desire to take the prison earlier, but for practical reasons. Now it seems to be more out of spite. He just wants the prison and everyone in it dead. Governor also shows signs of suicidal tendencies. For example, during the first attack on the prison, he just stands up straight, not ducking behind cover, even though the other side is shooting at him. He almost gets hit by several bullets, but doesn't even seem to care. Instead, he just grins. Pretty fucking badass, by the way. I also love the way he psychotically laughs while watching the van full of walkers ran through the prison gates. That is one deliciously mad supervillain. Soon, the governor also begins to draft ordinary Woodbury citizens into his war with Rick. Anyone fit enough is forced to join his army. Clearly, he no longer even cares about Woodbury at all. All he cares about is getting to prison, killing Rick and his people, and of course, most importantly, killing Michonne. He's become a truly evil monster. But there was a journey to it, unlike the comics. Michonne had a lot to do with this, so let's compare Blake's vendetta with her between the two mediums. In the comics, Michonne never kills Penny. In fact, Penny is left alive. Well, you know what I mean. And her ultimate fate is never revealed. However, Michonne does more to the governor physically than on the show. In the show, she just stabs out his eye. While in the comics, she goes a lot further. And I mean a lot. Let's just say he's left barely half a man. To be fair, this was in return for him beating and raping her earlier. Something which never happened in the series. Although he did try to have her killed by sending Merle after her. I suppose both governors have reasons to hate Michonne, but the comics version especially certainly had it coming. No matter how bad she mutilated him, I can't bring myself to sympathize with you, Governor. You got what you deserved. The TV show took a turn with the governor which the comics never did. Namely, it broke him and then built him up again. This is my favorite part of the character's run on the show, and as noted, it was entirely absent from the comics. In a fit of rage and madness, Governor kills his own entire army when they suddenly refuse to fight his insane war. The guy completely snapped, to put it mildly. Shortly afterwards, his most trusted men, the only ones he didn't kill, abandon him. By then, Woodbury had also been evacuated by Rick, leaving the town empty. Everything that the governor built up is gone, and all because of his own insanity. This causes a drastic change in the character. Now, he really has nothing left to live for. No town to govern, no people to protect, no war to fight. Keep in mind that at this point, he'd also killed his own best friend, Milton, because he turned against him earlier. The governor is officially dead, and to cement this, he symbolically burns down the ghost town of Woodbury. Blake then sets out on a pointless journey all on his own, wandering around aimlessly, not caring whether he lives or dies. He no longer even pays any attention to walkers, ignoring as they snap their rotting teeth after him. During this time, he also seemed to become a fusion of Snake Plissken and RJ McCready. I think it's so fascinating to see this big scary supervillain fall so hard, and basically become a freaking vagrant. Just imagine if this happened to Dr. Doom or the Joker. This frankly pathetic state of the character actually helps to humanize him. He can be broken just like any of us, and can't just walk away from any horrible deed unscathed. Clearly, killing his own army had a major impact on him. As shown, it is immediately afterwards that he stops paying any attention to walkers, and would essentially just let one walk up to him and eat his face. Now it may sound like I'm painting up the governor as the true victim here and not the people he killed. Of course not. That's not what I'm saying at all. I'm just saying that a far less interesting villain would simply have killed his own people and then just ordered a pizza. But that's not the TV governor. He's not a stock archetype. He's a character. So this was the governor broken. But as I said, he was then rebuilt. Just like it seemed it was the end for old Philip Blake, and he literally lay down on the ground to just die, he found a new reason to live. Penny, alive and well. Well, not really Penny, but Megan is clearly supposed to be Penny. A little girl living with her mom, aunt, and granddad in a shabby apartment, Megan spotted Governor lying on the ground waiting for death. She assumed it was her dad, finally having returned after he left years ago. How fitting. Megan finds her dad, and Governor finds his daughter. With this family, the Governor found a reason to live again, and he also found a way to become a much better man. Probably something a lot closer to the man he used to be before all this shit happened. He also discarded any traces of his old identity, never referring to himself as Governor nor Philip Blake ever again, instead taking the name Brian. If things had just been left like this, everything would have been fine. But no, of course not. It wasn't to be. Fate was much crueler to both Brian and Rick Grimes. As circumstances would have it, Brian and his new family were forced on the road, and eventually ran into his old right-hand man, Martinez, the man who'd abandoned him earlier. This is where everything went down the drain again. Martinez now had a camp of his own, and he allowed Brian and his people to join them. At this point, Brian only cared about the safety of his new family, and didn't want to be a governor and lead again. He wanted nothing to do with power any longer. But slowly, he begins to realize that the camp isn't safe at all, and Martinez is a crappy leader. He tries to leave first. Remember that scene in the middle of the night when he takes his family and packs up? But then the road turns out to be blocked by a herd of walkers, and there's no way around. They're thus forced to return to camp. What if that road hadn't been blocked? Things would have turned out entirely different. Stuck with this community, Brian decides that Martinez and any other leaders have to go. They can't do the job right. The only way to keep his family safe is to once again become the governor and take command. We then get a tragic de-evolution as Brian transforms back into the hideous governor, and eventually also sets his sights back on the prison again, concluding that it's the only real safe place. Of course, when we end, Brian seems to have completely lost himself in the governor, and doesn't even remember why he wanted the prison again in the first place. He doesn't flinch when Megan turns up dead, nor does he care how many of his own die in the battle for the prison. It's just senseless destruction. There's no purpose to it. Brian may have wanted to keep his family safe, but the governor is just an agent of chaos and mayhem. Of course, fittingly enough, that's where it all ends. And even more fittingly, by the blade of Michonne, no less. He reached his final limit. There was no more destruction that could be caused. Perhaps he was glad it was all over. Maybe not the governor, but Philip Blake and Brian most certainly. This fascinating character arc never takes place in the comics. There, the governor simply attacks the prison over and over until he dies. I would say, though, that where the comic is superior is in the sheer scale of that final attack. It's so much more devastating than in the TV show, and basically half the story's cast of characters are killed off in one freaking issue. On a final note, I want to compare the look of comic and TV governor. This guy is supposed to be a charismatic leader whom everyone looks up to. Well, does this guy look like that? This raggedy ass bum? No, David Morrissey obviously fits that part a lot better, and the clean cut, dashing style they went with on the show is far superior. Morrissey also pulled off a fantastic performance as a character, and I can't really praise him enough. He's both charming and scary as hell. Kinda reminds me of Two-Face, actually. He could probably play a great Harvey Dent. I love that accent of his too. He's doing a southern accent, but the actor is British, so it doesn't sound quite right. Kinda off, which just adds to the character's uniqueness in my opinion, and makes him seem larger than life. So there it is, my opinions on the comic book version and the TV version of the Governor. One is a fascinating and incredibly layered villain, the other not so much. Of course, I understand some people actually prefer the comic version, and that's totally fine. Everyone is entitled to their own opinions. I also realize that comic Governor is fleshed out further in the novels, but as I said, the novels are still a different medium and not the comics. Honestly, I myself haven't even read the novels, although I probably will someday. Now, I could have gone on a lot longer about the governor. I mean, I didn't even mention his fish tank filled with heads, or his relationship with Andrea. Nor did I really talk about how he manipulates people with lies and deceit. But I think this video has gone on long enough. It's time to cut it here. I realize this is a pretty random video, even more random than Darkwing Duck perhaps, but that's how it's going to be from now on. I'm gonna do what I want to do, and this is a video I wanted to do for a long time. Of course, forgotten villains and heroes will still continue, as will other DC and Marvel stuff, so don't worry about that. As a matter of fact, my very next video will be a good old-fashioned forgotten supervillain, and soon I'll also review the Scarecrow miniseries Kings of Fear. As for this series, I'm not sure if there will be any more. This is sort of a standalone video, but I'm calling it a series just in case. After all, I may want to do similar videos later. Who knows? Anyway, whatever the future holds, as always, remember, Arkham Asylum awaits you in the next video.